Paul and Barnabas returned to their home base in their church in Antioch of Syria, and they began to recount all the things that God had done on the mission field during their first journey, and how the Gentile world, the Greek-speaking world, was responding to the gospel, and new communities that looked a lot like the community in Antioch were beginning to pop up all over the place. But something happens shortly after they get back. Luke doesn't give us much detail in his account. He just says a group of believers comes from Jerusalem, Jewish believers, and they begin to teach something different than what Paul and Barnabas had been teaching the church in Antioch and the churches that they were starting in the Greek-speaking world. But Paul gives us some deeper detail in his letter to the church in Galatia. He tells us that first after they get back, a group of people from Jerusalem come up, and they are led by Peter himself. And when they come, there's no problem at all. As they eat common meals together in fellowship, there's no dividing wall between Jew and Gentile. They're all intermixed, and they're eating together, and they're accepting each other in this new community following after Jesus of Nazareth. But a second group comes up. And once this second group comes up, the Jewish believers in Antioch, including the original party that came from Jerusalem, begin to change their behavior. They begin to separate from the Gentile believers and eat in a different area and different tables than the Gentiles and refuse to fellowship with them during common meals. Paul looks at this and he sees that not only is Peter drawn away by this foolishness, but it's also Barnabas who gets pulled along by this foolishness. And so he decides that he's going to make a public confrontation of it. And he calls Peter out because he knows that Peter's the key figure here. If Peter continues this kind of action, then there's no way they're going to change the mind of the others. But if Peter, the one who was so beloved by Jesus and who followed Jesus and whom Jesus had seemed to given much authority to after he ascended, if Peter would relent of this behavior and go back to the way he was acting before, then the issue would be resolved. And so he tells Peter, you've been acting like a Gentile all this time, and now all of a sudden you're going to backtrack and you're going to act differently just because this group has come up from Jerusalem? The matter was one that was really important. For the Gentile world, this was important because for the Jewish believers to demand that Gentiles first convert to Judaism meant that there was an extreme barrier of entry to becoming a Christian, a follower of Jesus of Nazareth. And so as they went about their business and were coming to worship this new God, if they all of a sudden heard that they needed to join this new covenant, it would have been really difficult for them to begin to explore it or to come into this new community, especially for the men, because of the issue of circumcision. And so it would have been important for Paul to get this resolved and for there to be a final word on what was going on. And so that's why he makes a big public confrontation to make sure that this issue is going to be dealt with. Now, there's other reasons why this issue was so significant in the first century for the Jewish contingent that was coming from Jerusalem. We've already looked at and talked a little bit about the history of the Jewish people and the importance of the purity of God's people being set apart and separate from the cultures around them. And how every single time in the history of Israel, they began to intermingle and to mix their faith with the faiths around them and with the people around them, that they would get themselves in trouble. They would stop following the decrees of the Lord, and they would stop worshiping only the one true God, and they would begin to do things that made God unhappy and would end in their sadness and their grief and their loss as God removed his protections from them so that they might return to him eventually. And so they were fearful that if this intermingling began and if there began to be a kind of dilution of what they believed was most important in worshiping the one true God, that there would be real consequences that would come from it. Now, there was other pressures as well. The second pressure we've kind of looked at before, and that is the special relationship that the Jewish people had with the Roman authorities. The Jewish people were allowed to not follow some of the decrees and the rules of the Roman Empire so that they could stay in faithfulness in their own religion, observance of the Sabbath, not worshiping the Caesar or the emperor cult, not participating in temple festivities and worship, not eating meat that was sacrificed to idols, various different things like this that they were allowed to do that the Romans had given a special leeway to. Now, that they were a small group within the empire, and so the Romans were willing to give this small leeway. But if all of a sudden a whole bunch of uncircumcised Roman people or Greek-speaking people within the Roman rule began to claim the same kind of special nature that the Jewish people had, it would all of a sudden raise the eyebrows of Rome. And Rome might start rethinking their agreement with the Jewish people. Now, this was important for multiple reasons. One, for the Christian believers, that they would be able to continue to follow after the ways they thought was pure and holy in the Lord and not have Rome persecuting them. But also, the Jewish believers in Jerusalem would have had a special pressure from the Jewish believers or from the Jewish authorities that had not believed in Jesus. They had begun to kind of lessen some of the pressure on the early church. And if all of a sudden Rome was putting pressure on the authorities in Jerusalem, then for sure they would start bringing back the pressures on this small beginning group of followers of Jesus of Nazareth. And so these pressures all kind of came together and became a reality for the early church in a way that leaded to conflict and needed resolution in some way in order for the church to continue forward united under one God and one community from then on.